Now, from those very tiny fast rhythms, which give us the impression of continuity, there are also in this universe immensely slow rhythms. And these are very difficult for us to keep track of. And they impress us and depress us as our own life and death, as our coming and going, which goes for what is, to us, such a slow pace that we can't possibly believe that it is really a rhythm. We think of it as our birth, as something quite unique that could never occur again because we're so close to it, you see, and it's moving so slowly. And so with that point of view, we are, like Marshall McLuhan has said, he borrowed a metaphor from me, which is that we are driving a car looking at the rear vision mirror. That means that the environment in which you believe yourself to exist is always a past one. It isn't the one you're actually in. The process of growth, the basic process of biology, is one in which lower orders are always being superseded by higher orders. But the lower order can never figure out, or only very rarely figure out, what the higher order is that's taking over. And may see it as a terrible threat, as total disaster, as the very end. But therefore can never be aware that the principle of growth always has and always will continue. Whereas that's what's going on. But you never know what the next step is going to be. Because if you did know, you wouldn't take it, because it would already be past. Do you understand this? That any certainly known future is an event of which we can say, you've had it. And in that sense, it's past. When we play games, and we say in chess or in bridge or whatever game you're playing, the outcome of the game becomes certain, we at that point cancel the game and begin a new one. Because the whole zest of the thing, and which takes me back to the idea that this whole thing is a hide-and-seek game, is that you don't know what the next order coming up is. But one thing you can be sure of, it will be an order, and it will comprehend you. At the moment, we stand at a time in history where we're beginning to think of the great countdown on the end of the human race. Terrifying possibility that through atomic energy, we may obliterate this planet, and turn the whole globe into a star. Maybe that's the way all the stars started. Imagine, you know, this great thing coming up. The countdown on the end. 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Bam! Where have you heard that before? You sit on the seashore and you hear the waves going in and out, and you don't stop to think. That's what you're doing. That's what the whole business is doing. And there are places where the wave mounts and mounts and it gets too big for its boots or whatever, and it spills and breaks. And we could do just that. But very important to realize that that's what you're doing, because then you don't get panicky about it. And the person who's going to press that button is a person who's going to be in panic. So if you realize that that's what it is, and that it doesn't really matter if the whole human race blows itself up, then there's a chance that it won't do it. That's the only chance we have. Not to do this thing which attracts us like a kind of vertigo, like a person who looks over a precipice and is all set to throw himself over. Or a person who jumps out of a plane when they're skydiving and forgets to pull the parachute ring because he gets fascinated with a target. called target fascination. He just goes straight at it, you see. So we can get absolutely fascinated with disaster, with doom. Or, you know, all the news in the newspapers is invariably bad news. There is no good news in the newspapers. People wouldn't buy a newspaper consisting of good news. Even the free press is full of terrible news. Except the San Francisco Oracle. And the fascination, you see, for this doom might be neutralized if we would say, well, why bother about that? It's just another fluctuation in this huge, marvelous, endless chain of our own selves and our own energy going on. See, here's the problem. Because of our myopia, because of our the way we've, as it were, restricted consciousness to focus upon just that certain little area of experience that we call voluntary action. That's us. And everything else happens to us. Now, that's obviously absurd. Let's suppose you take in your hand one of those toys, a gyroscopic top. And you suddenly notice, the minute you get this in your hand, that it has a kind of vitality to it. It seems to resist you. It starts pushing you in a certain way, see? And sometimes you're with it and following it. And then sometimes you see it. It's just as if you held a living animal in your hand. You know, you pick up a hamster. You know, or a guinea pig, and you hold this little thing in your hand, it's always trying to escape. So the gyroscope always seems to be trying to escape your hold. Now, in exactly the same way, what you're experiencing all the time, all sorts of things are getting out of control and doing things you don't expect. It's trying to escape your hold. All right, then don't grab it so hard.